Hi, welcome to the Sales Influence Response Block Selling Program, an innovative approach to creating a persuasive sales presentation. Now, this presentation is geared for people who are out there going to train on response block selling. I'm your host, Victor Antonio. Please follow along. Now, the first slide I typically show is this thing called the sales process. Now, this is basically the several steps that you're going to need within the sales process to actually make a sale. Let's go through them one by one closely. Prospecting, that's when you basically go out and try to find new potential clients. Once you've got a bunch of potential clients, you then walk into what they call the qualifying phase. In other words, make sure that these are the right type of buyers for your product. Then, in the investigating process, what we do is actually sit down with the customer and basically ask questions, discover their needs so we can sell more effectively down the road here. The next step is presenting. Once we understand the client's needs, we then present our product in that light. The next step, once we've presented our product, we actually do a proposal, which is actually the pricing. And then the last phase typically is closing. Now, the reason I show this slide is basically to get a common understanding with the folks in the audience about the different steps in the sales process and to emphasize that most people spend their time on the last phase of the sales process. Most of the training you'll see out in the market today really focuses in on just closing techniques. Response block selling really focuses in on the last three, which is presenting, proposing, and closing a sale. So when you're talking to your audience, that's how I want you to put it in that context. We're talking about presenting, proposing, and closing. We're not going to talk about prospecting, qualifying, or investigating. Simply, how do we make an effective presentation and then close that prospect? So let's go look at the ABC techniques that most people use. And I always bring this part up because, again, most people are taught about closing techniques. And ABC stands for what? Always be closing. And so when you look at the different closing techniques, there's the assumptive close. The assumptive close basically means, based on everything I've showed you, Mr. Customer, are we ready to get started? Let's go ahead and get the paperwork done. That's an assumptive close. The alternative close is basically, would you like to take delivery on Monday or would you like to take delivery on Wednesday? Giving the client an option. Then there's the scarcity close. Well, I only have two left. You might want to buy them while they're available. And a cousin of the scarcity is the last chance. Well, once these are gone, Mr. Customer, guess what? We're not going to make any more. And then one of the most famous of all closing techniques is the Ben Franklin. That's where you draw a line down the middle. On the left-hand side, you ask the customer, let's put all the reasons you shouldn't buy. And then let's go on the right-hand side, put all the reasons you should buy. And it always works out that you always have more reasons to buy. And then what you do is you show the customer the actual list and say, look, Mr. Customer, based on what we've written down, let's go ahead and get the process started. These are typical closing techniques that are used in sales today. And when I do this workshop, what I want to do is just remind people of how they've been taught. And then I ask the question, do sales training closing techniques really work? There's something called the sales reactance theory. People will move away when you pressure them to buy. At this point, you want to ask your audience if they agree with you. And if you simply say something like, based on what I've shown you, do we all agree that pressuring people today to actually close a sale can work against you? And I think you'll get a lot of head nods going, yeah, they could be. Now, so what I did is I then go into this little graph here, and it was done by the Huthaway Company. It was a study done on closing techniques, and they wanted to study whether closing techniques did work. And so they bracketed them into two pieces, high close calls and low close calls. Now, every time somebody attempted a closing behavior, similar to the ones I talked about, the alternative close, or let's say the Ben Franklin close, this is called the closing behavior. And so what they found is that, on average, people who tried to close 5.8 times, almost six closing behaviors were used during a phone call, they were only able to sell 37%. They then did a study where they actually used less closing behaviors, 1.4. In other words, they used one, maybe two closes during the sales call. And guess what? 70% of all the deals were closed. Now, at this point, this kind of wakes up your audience a little bit and says, you know, what's going on here? We've been taught that if you use a lot of closing behaviors, you should sell more. But based on what I'm showing you right here, those who use 5.8 or 6 closing techniques only sold 37%, while on the other side, those who use 1 to 2 closing techniques closed almost 70%. So something's not right here. We've been taught to close or use a lot of closing behaviors, but in this case, what this study is showing you that using too many closing behaviors will actually reduce the amount of sales you're actually going to be able to close. I then want to show you this one, training on closing techniques and success rate. They then did a study where they wanted to find out if maybe the reason they didn't close as many deals was because the actual salespeople weren't trained on closing techniques. So what they then did is they studied them before and after they trained them. And here's what they found. Before they were trained, the average person would use 3.2, let's call it three closing behaviors or three closing techniques, and they sold a little over 60%. After they were trained on how to use more closing behaviors, they used on average 5.6 or almost six closing behaviors per phone call, and guess what? Their actual sales rate dropped. In other words, when they used less, they got more. When they used more closing techniques, they actually sold less. One step. Wait a minute. Stop. At this point, you might be asking, and I know the audience will be asking, says, well, Victor, people buy emotionally and rationalize logically afterwards. Let me just say that slowly. People buy emotionally and then rationalize it logically afterwards. Now, this is what you often hear. So what's going on here? Well, let's go ahead and look at that closely. Let's talk about closing pressure. If I'm selling a $100 printer, and somebody tries to close me on a $100 printer, that's considered a small sale. The pressure is somewhat positive because it's moving me or nudging me to buy, but the commitment is small. It's only $100, and it's also a one-time deal. Said another way, if the printer doesn't work and I really don't want to keep it, for $100 and I consider that disposable income, it's not a big deal. I can just toss the thing away and just go buy a new one. But what happens when you're buying a printer that costs, let's say, $500,000? Well, now the pressure is considered negative because the commitment that you're about to make, $500,000 worth, is much larger. And also, it's not a one-time deal. If you buy from this company, this $500,000 printer, guess what? There's going to be a continued relationship in terms of maintenance and support. So from this graph, you can see, or this screen, you can see that a small sale, the pressure is positive. It's not a big deal if you're pressuring people to close. But when it comes to a very large sale, using pressure techniques or pressuring somebody to buy is viewed as negative based on the fact that the commitment is larger. And again, it's an ongoing relationship. So therein lies the difference when to use pressure or closing techniques and when not to. Within a small sale, go ahead and use them. Within a large sale, you don't want to use them. Now, they then did a study on closing techniques and customer satisfaction. In other words, how satisfied were customers once they bought under two conditions, pressure versus non-pressure? And here's what they found. In the first sample of 59 people, the sellers were trained to use closing techniques. And then they were asked key questions, customer satisfaction, 3 to 5 days after the purchase. And then they were asked the likelihood of them buying again. So the customer rating of likelihood of further purchase. Here's what they found. For sellers who were trained on using closing techniques, the customer satisfaction was 5.8 out of 10, almost 6 out of 10 on what they call a Likert scale. They then wanted to find out what was the likelihood of these people actually going back and buying when they were pressured into buying. And 5.2 out of 10 would actually go back and buy. In other words, 50% of the people would go back and buy, 50% wouldn't. Now, what happens when the sellers didn't use closing techniques? Let's look at those numbers. The customer satisfaction rate was 7.7. That's almost 80%. Almost 8 out of 10 people said they were satisfied with their purchase 3 to 5 days after when they weren't pressured to buy. Likelihood of them buying again? Again, almost 80%, 7.8, we'll call that 8. 8 out of 10, 80% would actually buy again. And this makes sense. We've all heard the dictum, you know, it's easier to keep a customer than it is to go out and get a new one. So in other words, keep your customer satisfied by not pressuring them to buy. It's a more positive experience. Because what happens when you pressure people to buy, they have something called buyer's remorse. They start thinking, maybe I shouldn't have bought this product. And then they start feeling bad about the fact that they bought the product. And then they associate that feeling, that bad feeling, with the company that actually sold it to them. And when people feel bad about what they bought, they feel very, what? You got it. Buyer's remorse. They feel very screwed. So what we want to do is look at it differently. What if we can actually, instead of pressuring people to buy, what if we can nudge them to buy, or the actual